What's up, y'all? Welcome back to my channel. It's SeantaMarie here, and I am a military lifestyle vlogger here on the tube. I thank you guys so much for clicking on this video and taking the time to watch. Make sure, if you haven't already, that you hit the subscribe button. I really enjoy making content for you guys in hopes that it can help you out in some way, shape, or form. So today I'm gonna be telling you guys my cons, because if you haven't already seen it, I made a pros video and you guys just really wanted to see the cons. A lot of you guys are on the fence about whether or not you want to join the military or the National Guard. That's the branch that I am in. I mentioned it previously in other videos, but it is like very difficult for me to think of cons for the military, because for every con, I can think of a way to turn it into a positive and vice versa. Let's just go ahead and jump right in. I have a list like usual. The first thing, your civilian career. So if you're thinking about joining the National Guard and you want to just be your 1 weekend a month, 2 weeks out of the year, which is called an M-Day soldier, it is kind of difficult to get civilian careers. A lot of people talk about how it is a positive. I even talked about how being in the military is a positive for employers, and it's kind of one of those things that it depends on the type of job that you're looking for. So say you're in college and you want a part-time job. Most of those part-time jobs, the primary time frame they're gonna want you to work is in the evenings and on the weekends. Well, if you're in the National Guard, you're obviously only going to be able to commit to 3 weekends out of the month for that, and then you're also gone during the summertime for 2 weeks out of the year. So sometimes that can conflict with getting a job. I've had both, where people thought it was awesome that I was in the National Guard and I got jobs, and I've also had where I knew that I did not get jobs because I was in the National Guard. So to each their own. You just really have to make sure that you are properly selling yourself when it comes to applying for jobs. The second one is that the weekends in the National Guard are not always just Saturday and Sunday. A lot of times you will have to do other sorts of drill periods. So you may have to come in on a Friday for like a half day and then work Saturday, Sunday. And then if you're like preparing for deployment or something, there is just a lot more time that you have to devote to the National Guard. For me, I'm like, if you're an M-Day soldier, it just means like you're getting more money, you're getting more time to work with your section. So I don't really see it as a negative, but if you join thinking that you're only gonna have to do your Saturday and Sunday and then the 2 weeks out of the year, just be prepared that that may not always be the case. All right, another con is that the higher ranking that you get, the more work and the more duties that you're expected to do. So before I became an NCO in the National Guard, I really feel like I wasn't expected to do a ton of stuff outside of drill weekend. And this is another thing that it's like, to each their own. There are people who are NCOs that go home after drill weekend and they never think about drill until drill weekend is actually happening. And then there are the good NCOs who go home and they continue to check in on their soldiers, make sure they're working on PT, make sure that training schedules are in place for the next drill weekend, making sure that you're not gonna go to drill and just be bored. The higher ranking you are, the more responsibility that you have. And if you want your soldiers to be ready at all times, that's the only way that that's gonna happen. So for me, drill weekend is not just a once a month situation. I think about it all the time, especially like now that I'm AGR, yeah, especially now, but even before I was AGR, I still thought about drill weekend more often than none, because you can't expect to just show up to drill and for everything to work perfectly. Like, you have to plan and prepare. All right, so a fourth con for the National Guard is a lot of members struggle with PT and height weight, because in the active duty world, you're doing PT every day. If you're working a civilian career and the National Guard is your part-time job, a lot of people don't, well, they claim that they don't have the time to work out, or they just feel like they don't have the time, or they don't have the motivation, or they may not know what to do without somebody being there to tell them what to do. So a lot of times PT can be a con, because not having to do it all the time makes it difficult for you to pass your PT test. The next thing is kind of weird, but I put relationships down on my list because relationships in the National Guard, it's its own beast. Unfortunately, since you do only have drill weekend once a month, you obviously make friends at drill, and then you may know people that are in your unit or in other units that outside of the National Guard. So when it comes to like being in a relationship, whether it's like a significant other or whatever, it's very difficult. Like the lines can be crossed in the military. Everybody knows perception is reality, and like it just is very difficult. Like I've seen the worst freaking E5s that are like married to lieutenant colonels and shit. So it's crazy. And it's one of those things where it's like, if you're well liked, like there's things you can get away with. And if you're not well liked, like you're probably screwed, especially if it's like officer enlisted, or like you're both enlisted, but one's like higher ranking than the other. Like that's a whole thing on its own. Like you can get in so much trouble, but in the National Guard, it's like, it's almost like the lines are so blurred that no one knows right from wrong, which is bad to say, but it's true. And I've seen it, and I've personally like dealt with it. So it's just nuts. That could honestly be its own video, but yeah, I put that. And then I also put like in the civilian world, relationships, like say you're in the National Guard and you're trying to date in the civilian world. Every relationship that I have been in with someone where they were in the military just ended up being like foul, like real bad. Never want to experience it again. Honestly, if you can get away with not being with someone in the military, like just don't do it to yourself, girl. Like don't even try. But trying to find someone in the civilian world who understands the National Guard lifestyle and understands that there are gonna be weekends that you're gonna be gone. There are gonna be weeks where you have to work on stuff for the National Guard. And not only that, as a female National Guard service member, trying to find a man that is honestly okay with me working in a male dominant field, or me working in a career that is seen as a male dominant field, like I don't know, it's just very hard. And it's hard to find people who are understanding. It's easy to be taken advantage of, because if they think, oh, you're in the National Guard, then they can be like, well, that means I get one free week in a month to like do whatever the F I want to do. And it's just, it's I see it as a con. Relationshiping is a con. I mean, clock's ticking, I'm 27, ain't no one in sight. You know, it's a con. It took me a long time to make this list, I just want you to know. But I thought of things that frustrate me as a National Guard member. This is like M-Day soldier problems. So the people who do 2 weeks out of the year and the 1 week in a month situation, this is for you. So I put that it is very hard to get schools. The main reason being because you're only allotted so much money per year, like each state is, for certain schools. And there's always people who need one school more than somebody else. There's so many situations that could come up for that. So budget is a big deal as far as getting schools. And also, I just want to point out, like, I'm in the Kansas National Guard, and obviously states like Texas, California, Florida, they have way more money to spend because that's a bigger state. It also affects your career development, because there are schools that you have to be able to progress to the next level. And these things don't really start affecting you, honestly, until you become an NCO. But there's like these things called NCOES, and they're like schools that you have to make it to the next level. So like me, I need a school right now called ALC. Well, for my MOS, there's one slot. So one person gets to go to that school every year. For you to get promoted in the National Guard, it is way more difficult for National Guard service members to get promoted. And a lot of people don't believe that, but it is 100% the truth. You have to have a slot for your MOS to be able to get promoted. So it's another thing where it's fine until you hit about E5. And then after that, it's like starts to get more and more difficult, especially depending on what MOS you choose. So I'm gonna be making a video about my like top three choices for MOSs in the National Guard. All right, so the next thing that I put is kind of funny, to be honest, but I put treated poorly for being in the National Guard. I didn't know how to word it, but I talked about it in my pros video, but there are some stores and stuff that do not accept you as a military service member for store discounts, which this isn't that big of a deal, but like, I want to flip every single store the bird who does this. The number one store that I can think of that does this is Champs. If you are not active duty, they will not give you the store discount. The last con that I really have is that reclassing in the National Guard is really hard. I don't know that that's hard for active duty. I really don't know. But for National Guard, like it's taken me 7 years to reclass, because I wanted to be a 42 Alpha like really bad, and I actually get to reclass next summer, but it's taken me 7 years. So like, whatever MOS you pick from the beginning, like take it seriously. This concludes my video of all of the cons for the National Guard. Like I said, it was so hard for me to make this list for you guys. I hope that it helped you guys out, especially those of you that are on the fence. At the end of the day, I would not trade joining the National Guard for anything in the world. It has been the greatest experience for me, and I hope that I can continue to share and document my journey and experiences with you on this platform. The last thing that I want to mention is I did a live video and told you guys that I started a Patreon account. So if you guys want to go and check that out, it's a pretty awesome thing to do, but I will be providing ASVAB tutoring through there. If you're interested, the link will be in the bottom for you guys. Thank you guys so much for watching. Make sure you like, comment, subscribe to the channel, and I will catch you guys in my next video. Bye, guys.